The psalmist calls out, "Sing praise to the Lord, O faithful ones, and give thanks to God's holy name. For divine anger lasts but a moment, but divine favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes in the morning." Please rise in body or in spirit for the call to worship. We gather today to worship the one who created us, the one who calls us, the one who equips us, the one who loves us without end. With joyful hearts, let us worship God.
God's love for us knows no bounds. Because of this love, we come before our God, confessing our wrongdoings, first in silence, then as a community of faith. And now, praying together. God, save us from resisting new paths. We continue to do the same things over and over, expecting different results. God, save us from doing too much. We go about our daily routines, not always recognizing your presence with us. God, save us from doing too little. We say we love you, yet at times neglect the work you've called us to do. God, save us from resisting new paths. Help us to hear and respond when you say, "Follow me." Jesus is gentle with our doubts. The Spirit offers peace in the midst of our lack of understanding. The one who created us leads us step by step into deeper trust. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please rise in body or in spirit as we sing.
Having received God's forgiveness and love and peace, let us share that peace with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please share the peace with one another with a word or a wave.
To invite kids to join me and Julie at the back, and we will return after the sermon, so all kids may come with us.
And now let us pray before the reading and preaching of God's word. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. May they implant themselves in our lives and motivate us to go out and be your people in the world. Amen. And now, a reading from God's Word, John chapter 21. Listen to God's Word to us this day. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We'll go with you." They went out, got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple, whom Jesus loved, said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the lake. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. So though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now, none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time, he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." This is the word of the Lord. So I don't think I can ever remember a time I was more hungry than the morning after my wedding day. My husband and I had woken up late, and by the time we had packed and checked out and gotten our car, we were in significant low blood sugar zone, which I'm convinced plays a factor in at least 50% of all relationship quarrels. You see, I wanted to spend our first morning as a married couple going out to breakfast and, you know, treating ourselves to an obscene amount of sugar and carbs. But this new husband of mine rationally explained that by the time we picked a place and we drove there and we waited for a table and we ordered our food, a lot of time would have passed, and one of us doesn't do very well on an empty stomach. So we compromised and went to Starbucks for breakfast sandwiches. Then we proceeded to get our laundry, clean and pack, and get ready for our honeymoon. I remember even to this day how bizarre it felt to spend so much time and energy preparing for this massive life event, such as a wedding, and then the next day you're arguing over plans, doing your laundry, cleaning your house. It all felt so normal, like nothing had changed at all. The disciples, they have experienced something life-changing, something world-changing. Jesus, as we know, their teacher, their Lord, their leader, has risen from the dead and appeared to them. Just last week, Christy preached about how after Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared to the disciples in a locked room, offering them a word of peace and breathing the Holy Spirit into their lives. Then, a week later, he appeared again. So Thomas, who was, for whatever reason, absent during the first few appearances, could touch Jesus' wounds and have his faith restored. You would think that no one would ever be the same again, that nothing would be the same again after such an incredible occurrence. But as it turns out, sometimes it's harder to live into transformation than disappointment. I even wonder if the disciples were perhaps more prepared to deal with the realities of Jesus' crucifixion than his resurrection. After all, they were used to a world that was defined by death and oppression, where worldly power and corruption wins by force every time. But what about the miraculous? Even after 3 years of Jesus doing the unexpected and the unexplainable, the disciples, they were nowhere near prepared to know what to do with the resurrection. And I guess I find that really comforting. I mean, if the disciples who got to see and touch and inhabit the same physical space with the resurrected Jesus, if they didn't know what to do with the resurrection, maybe it's understandable that a lot of the time we don't really know what to do with the resurrection either. When it comes to Jesus' resurrection, we believe that it reveals something pretty amazing and powerful about God, and that it changes something for us and for the world, but we don't always know what it changes or how it changes things. And let's be honest, sometimes we aren't even totally convinced it does change all that much, especially when we look out at our world and we still see the presence of so much death and oppression and war. Our world still seems so defined by these things. I remember in seminary, one of my professors asked us to think about what would be different for our lives if the resurrection had never happened. It's a tough question. And by this point, we had learned that most of the Sunday school answers we were taught as children didn't quite cut it in seminary. So after a long, awkward silence, one of my classmates bravely piped up, "Well, I guess death would be a whole lot scarier, and hope in the seemingly impossible, well, that would feel pretty pointless." That seemed like a good answer. Several months ago, my son Grayson started thinking and talking about death a lot. He would come to Peter or I, usually right around bedtime, with tears in his eyes, and weakly say, "My brain is thinking about death again, and I can't make it stop." I would think about and tell him all the age-appropriate answers I could come up with, and we would talk about how sometimes bodies do stop working, but that his body was healthy and strong, and there was no reason to think it would stop working anytime soon. And then we would sit together, and we would take some deep breaths, and I would give him a hug, but I could see that even my hugs and my explanations weren't able to totally lift this very heavy burden off his tiny shoulders. And then one day, while I was driving Grayson to school, we started talking about Easter and why we celebrate it. And I started trying to explain why we celebrate the resurrection and found this pretty hard to do in an age-appropriate way with a five-year-old. So I told him, "Easter reminds me that death is not the end of the story, and that in the end, love wins." To which Grayson replied, "Oh, do we have any snacks in this car?" That's how a lot of our car conversations end these days. But then a few days later, I heard him talking to his grandparents, and he said, "Grandma, Grandpa, do you know why we celebrate Easter?" And they said, "No, why don't you tell us?" And he got this huge smile on his face, and he said, "Because death is not the end of our story." The disciples, they have seen Jesus. They now know that death was not the end of Jesus' story. But they don't know what to do with this new information. So they do what they know. Peter says, "I'm going to go fishing." And the rest of the disciples, who've gotten pretty good at following these days, said, "We're going to follow you. We'll go with you." They fish all night, but they catch nothing. That is, until Jesus shows up at dawn and tells them to try again. This time, they catch such an abundance of fish that they are uncertain as whether they can even haul it in without breaking their nets. It's also at this point that the disciples recognize that the person on the shore who told them where to fish is Jesus. And as soon as Peter hears that Jesus is on the beach, he puts on his clothes. Not sure why he was fishing naked or why he thought it would be good to put on his clothes before jumping in the water. But that's Peter for you. He never holds back, always acting on impulse. And so while Peter is making this mad dash to Jesus, the rest of the disciples responsibly stay back with the boat in order to haul in their catch. By the time the disciples reach the shore, Jesus has breakfast waiting for them, cooked fish and warm bread. And remember that large catch? Turns out that might not have all been for them, because Jesus had them covered with a sunrise breakfast, lovingly prepared and ready to eat. But never one to shy away from the opportunity for an object lesson, Jesus tells them to bring some of that fish anyway. Then Jesus took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish fillet, doing what Jesus does, feeding his disciples. And after breakfast, when everyone is fed, Jesus turns to Peter and asks him three times, "Peter, do you love me?" When Peter replies in the affirmative, Jesus says, "Feed my sheep." Feeding people, body and soul, it's so interwoven into Jesus' ministry. And now here he is again, calling Peter to follow him in this ministry of feeding people. But this time, he's also calling Peter to lead, to use Peter's gifts of passion and impulsivity and his readiness to jump in with both feet, to use all of this to feed Jesus' sheep, to carry on Jesus' ministry and mission. Three times Peter denied his calling and his discipleship, and three times Jesus is now calling him back into ministry, affirming that love for Jesus must always translate into action on behalf of others. It's not complicated, Jesus says. If you love me, feed my sheep. Oh, how we have complicated it. It's notable here that this call to the disciples to feed people comes right after Jesus helps them catch an abundance of fish. Because of Jesus, they now have this huge resource that they can offer to people. It reminds me of the story of the feeding of the 5,000 when Jesus asked his disciples to feed the very, very large crowd that had gathered. And the disciples are like, "How are we supposed to do that?" At that point, Jesus shows them the abundance of resources available to them to do what Jesus has asked them to do. Now, I'm sure when Jesus says, "Feed my sheep," he means more than just giving people food, although that is definitely part of it, as Jesus was always feeding hungry people. But I also think Jesus is inviting his disciples through this to recognize the abundance of God's kingdom with both the physical and the spiritual. He's inviting them to receive all the resources that God has to offer them and share those resources with the world. Resources of food, yes, and also love and compassion and grace and healing. That is all part of the call to discipleship, trusting and believing that God comes to us wherever we are, in whatever state we are in whatever state our faith is in, feeds us, and then invites us to take part in feeding the world. And then shows us the resources to do so. This post-resurrection story, it's a good reminder that God won't call us to do something and then leave us all alone to figure out how. Not that many haven't tried to, you know, be the church and feed the people all out of their limited resources and abilities, but that has almost always led to failure and burnout, or worse, the need to control who gets fed, as if only some are worthy. But if we trust that God will provide, that God will provide the resources to do the work that Jesus has called us to do, Jesus will continue to show up among us, to encourage us to keep trying and provide what we need and enough to share. Because if the only thing the church ever did was to show up and love and feed people the way that Jesus did, I truly believe the church would not be in decline today. The good news is that God does not give up on us. God is always calling us back to be sent out again to continue the work of loving and feeding people, because God refuses to let death be the end of the story. Amen.
Sing. Seated.
Welcome to worship at MIPC. My name is
Dan Hammer. I'm one of the pastors here, and know that as we gather both here in person as well as online, that God is with us. And through the prayers and the praises, the songs and the silence, through the hearts and the hands all around us, God reveals divine presence and purpose. As we begin a new week, there are a few things for us to be aware of. First, I'll ask Ruth Ann Biggers to raise her hand and stand up so you can all see who she is if you don't already. So Ruth Ann, this is letting me know that this is the final Sunday to put in an order for a name tag. So if you've seen these fancy name tags that are metal and magnetic, and you've really coveted other people's name tags and you've wondered how to get one, the answer is to talk to Ruth Ann after the service or give her a quick email and she'll set you up. And speaking of getting to know one another like we do when we know one another's names, tables of 8 or 7 or 9 is a great way to connect with people from church. This is also the last Sunday to sign up for that. This is a short-term commitment where groups meet together between May and August a few times in someone's home or at church or wherever they want for a series of meals. And Marla Briggs, I'll ask Marla to raise her hand, is organizing these signups and will place you in a group based on your schedule. You can sign up with Marla after the service or from the link on the MIPC homepage. Also, we've got a concert coming up this Saturday, May 7th at 7 p.m. The concert series is welcoming the group Winds 5. It's aptly named because it's made up of 5 wind players: flute, clarinet, oboe, bassoon, and horn. And for anyone familiar with Lauren Osimakopoulos, she is their flutist. She's a good friend of the series and, of course, has associations here at MIPC as well as Covenant Living. It's a vibrant group of young adult musicians who like to breathe new life into classic works while also including contemporary work of emerging composers. So that's Winds 5 this Saturday, May 7th at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary. And finally, we've got 2 great adult education opportunities that are happening right now. The Growing in Faith class is meeting Sundays at 9:30 in the Fireside Room through May. And right now the class is looking at characters from the Bible who used their privilege to further God's purposes and God's justice. Rosemary Sixby is leading that class. And then Wednesdays in May, Bible study resumes at 11 a.m. in the Fireside Room. And I'll say that Bible study, just as a concept, doesn't always excite me, but this Bible study is really good. Who all comes to Bible study and really, oh, look at these Bible study folks. These are really good conversations we have. We open the scriptures, we give some academic items, but also we kind of do a stream of consciousness and discuss the passages together, and it's a lot of fun. So if you happen to be free ever midday on a Wednesday, we're meeting at 11 in the Fireside Room. And now we remember that part of our worship is recognizing God's many gifts to us and committing ourselves to sharing what we've been given to meet needs near and far. So if you've brought offerings today, you can leave them in the box that's just behind the baptismal font inside the sanctuary doors after the service, or you can mail your gifts to the church office, or you can give online. So as we consider how we can share with others what we have, let us pray. Risen Christ, responding to your love and your grace, we offer our gifts of time, talent, and service. May our offerings contribute to the common good, we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. This is a joyful feast of the kingdom of God. This table here, this is not MIPC's table. This isn't a Presbyterian table. This is our Lord's table. People have gathered around tables like this for 2,000 years. It is made ready for those who love God and for those who want to love God more. So come, you who have much faith, and you who have little, you who have been here often, and you who have not been here for a long time, come, you who have never been here, you who have tried to follow, and all of us who have failed. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. We are here to give you worship and praise, O God. From the beginning, you have brought light and life into the world, the seasons that change, the generations that have walked this earth. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. And we come with hearts full of gratitude. Thank you for seeking us throughout history. You gather and forgive, and you pursue us without end. We give thanks for Jesus, whom you sent to be God with us, who saw people that felt invisible and invited them to a meal, showing us how to live with others. Jesus healed the broken, hinting at the wonders of your new creation. He broke down barriers and lived out a justice that we long for today. He worshiped you with every breath, dying and rising again. Jesus showed that love is stronger than death, and nothing is beyond your power to bring new life. As we come to share the riches of your table, we cannot forget the rawness of this earth. We cannot take the bread and forget those who are hungry, or the cup and forget those who are thirsty. We cannot hear your words of peace and forget the world at war. And so we are bold to offer prayers on our hearts and mind. We do pray for this world where your peace and justice is needed. Comfort your children whose lives are shaped by terror and tyranny. For all the places of war right now, places that we read about and places that we don't know the details of, from Ukraine to Sudan to Ethiopia to every place where people live in fear and fighting rages on. We pray for all who are struggling with day-to-day burdens in life, for those for whom making ends meet each day is a struggle, for pain that is visible and pain that is invisible. We hold up the family and friends of those grieving, the family of Jen Rutkin and Kyle O'Malley, David Chen, and Lorna Tilson, and for all who are receiving treatments or in the hospital or in recovery, those that we know of, those that we say aloud, those that we don't know about. Specifically today, we hold up Myrtle and Leslie and Mark. Hear our prayers, spoken and unspoken. Thank you for the power of your Spirit moving in this world today, constantly bringing hope and healing, And we pray that that same Spirit would move among us and take these ordinary elements of bread and cup and make them into a feast that nourishes us. Unite us as your people, and hear us as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the glory, and the glory forever. Amen.
And friends, we remember that on the night that Jesus was arrested, the night before he died, he gathered around a table with his disciples for a feast. During the supper, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new relationship in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Friends, as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim Christ's death until Christ rises again among us. So draw near to be nourished in faith and renewed in hope. Feast on God's dreams for life in the world. Taste what God still longs to do. In a moment, we'll have two serving stations in the front of the sanctuary. All of the elements are gluten-free. There's a bread part on one side and a juice part on the other side. You may take it and return to your seat and receive as you're ready. Everyone is welcome at this table. Parents, you may use your discretion, but all children are welcome to receive communion. When you are ready, please come. The table is ready.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, as we gather in this place, representing the world to you, may we go forth now to represent you to the world. As we've heard the word of grace from your word, may we extend that to others that we meet. As we've been fed at your table, given food for the journey, may we also meet the material needs of those who come our way. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Friends, we have gathered as God's people. We have been fed and nourished by God's word and at the Lord's table, and now we are being sent out into a world that is hungry for something good. So may you go in peace to love and serve and feed the world. Amen.